There has been a big fuss over these Yamaha sled engines. Yamaha is known for making quality racing machines, the Apex and the RX1, now being used in aircraft. Steve Henry explains why. New sponsor acquired. There's a lot of new people to the experimental world, and that's just talking about airplanes for a minute. And then there's a whole other group of people that's new to the experimental world for engines. And Yamaha is fairly new to the scene, and there's a lot of questions. I understand there's a Facebook forum that people are welcome to join and kind of sit back and watch and learn there. But if you could maybe tell the difference just from a couple of different designs of Yamaha, if you will, and that is the RX1 to the Apex, just so we can get kind of a brief knowledge of the differences.
Well, this is an RX1 and this is an Apex, and there's a lot of similarities, but there's some really big differences too. One is the end of the engine right here. It's different where you would have to attach a gearbox. So that's a pretty big deal. You can't use the same gearbox. This is the new Skytrax gearbox. This is what I really wanted the Apex when I started doing this, but nobody had a way to attach a gearbox on the Apex. But Teal Jenkins was making an adapter to put a Rotax gearbox on the RX1, so that's what I started out with. It's carbureted. It was kind of a pain getting the carburetors jetted. It's quite a little different jetting that you wind up with in an airplane than on the snowmobile. Whereas like the Apex, it's fuel injected. You don't do anything to the jetting at all. You take it out of the sled and put it in the airplane, you don't have to mess with that part. So that was one thing that's easier about the Apex. They both work good, although this is probably the biggest thing that makes the Apex more desirable is this gearbox that Skytrax builds, this purpose built for these Apexes, and he did it thinking that people were going to be turbo on these engines and really put some serious horsepower through them. And I've put, you know, my 300 horsepower Apex with this quite a few hours now, and I'm not saying I haven't had any troubles, but they haven't been major, and he's getting them worked out, and it's really working good. I mean, I have no qualms about flying over the forest with my Apex turbo Skytrax gearbox. I'm just as comfortable, if not more comfortable, flying over bad terrain in that than I used to be with my Rotaxes.
Yeah, we saw that last year, low and slow to Oshkosh with you, right?
Yeah, that was, and that was when I really was kind of having some little bit of teething problems with the brand new plane, and the suspension was a little different, and we didn't really have that engine dialed in, that turbo engine. I mean, I barely got that thing like 2 weeks or maybe 3 weeks before Oshkosh, and that was the prototype engine. So you can imagine getting all that installed and tested. Sure. And flying to Oshkosh, it was kind of a big deal at that point, but things are getting a lot more refined now. I'm kind of in a test pilot. I kind of bring it on myself because I want the latest, best, fastest, so I wind up being test pilot. But Highlander's a good plane. That's one thing about Highlander too. It's a really good plane if you are trying things that, you know, like engine stuff. It's so much better than a fast airplane. Sure. Because if you have to dead stick, man, I'd rather be in a big tire Highlander than just really anything I can think of.
More options to land.
Yeah.
So what are some of the other, so the induction system, carbureted versus fuel injection, that's different from the RX1, the Apex. What are the other differences you've noticed from the two platforms, if you will?
As far as operating them, this is supposed to be a little bit more power in the Apex. Honestly, I didn't really feel that when I went from my RX1 to my Apex. But there's so many things that can be different, like the gear ratio. I had a different gear ratio in my RX1 than I did in the Apex. That changes things. The prop. There's so many variables, you know, that's how I wonder how people can have these exact numbers. It climbs out at 596 feet a minute. I don't have numbers that are so specific. I don't know how they do it. But the performance is really equal. But again, this is just nicer because of the gearbox mostly. And the fuel injection is simpler. And it's a little newer.
The fuel injection, you're saying, is simpler because it's auto-adjusting for your altitude and lean, rich.
Yeah, and you don't have to jet it. You don't have to figure out the jets. What main jet does it like? What pilot jet does it like? Like on this, on the RX-1, I had to change the springs, you know, and the slides and the throttle body, their carburetors. And it took me a while getting the RX-1 dialed in for the carburetors, whereas the Apex, it's just, there's nothing to it.
And the RX-1 is rated at what versus the Apex?
What I am told is this is rated, the RX-1 is 140 and the Apex is 150.
And that comes from Yamaha?
Yeah.
Ratings, correct?
Yeah. And you know, that's in the sled. Our exhaust is different, of course. There's no way you can run an exhaust on an airplane like they have it in a snowmobile. And exhaust changes things. You can get losses or gains by how you do your exhaust. My first header that I made for the RX-1 was pipey as could be. I'd come in landing, and I work my throttle a lot when I'm landing. I'm on a little bit, and I'd want to give it just a little gas, and boy, I'd go up 10 feet because it'd come on like a pipey two-stroke. And I thought, it's my header. It's got to be my header, because these things just aren't like that normally. And so I made a different header, and yeah, that problem went away. Now it's very linear, both of them. Real nice linear power band, which is awesome for flying.
And the red line is pretty high on these engines, right? What's the red line?
It's like 11,000. In the sled, it's 11,000. If you ride one of these, you know, the Apex snowmobile, I'm not so sure. Yeah, I think it's the same on the RX-1, but I know on the Apex, because I've ridden several of those, you punch the throttle, it goes to 11,000 RPM, and it'll stay there until you let off the gas.
Okay, and what RPM are you operating at, for the most part, on average, whether it's in cruise, takeoff, or just normal operation?
On the normal Apex like this, the stock one, I seem to run a lot between 8,000 and 9,000 RPM, just flying around. And on the turbo one, I'm usually about 1,000 RPM less. I'm more like 7,000 to 8,000 RPM just flying around. If I'm competing, it's different. I mean, I'll repitch the prop. I want to get right up into the power band immediately, you know, for takeoff. I don't care what it cruises at then.
Yeah.
But for all around, good takeoff, good cruise, that's kind of the RPM ranges I'm running.
So non-competing, non-max STOL performance, what are you taking off at, and what are you cruising at RPM-wise, you think?
My, it's kind of interesting that takeoff, the static RPM, winds up being about the same exact same thing as my cruise RPM, and which is usually, like I say, between 8,000 and 9,000 on the stock Apex.
Okay. If you are finding value in this video, hit the like button and remember to subscribe, as it's really important for me to get sponsors like Airworx, Aero Adventure, WingBug, Griplock Ties, and new this month, Edge Performance. And right now, Griplock Ties has a special offer for USA customers. Go to their website and at checkout, get free shipping. Enter the code EXPERIMENTAL. Let's jump back in.
All right. If I'm in a competition, I'll repitch to where I'm like 10,000 RPM, 10 to 10.5.
And most of us are thinking, wow, that sounds like an insane amount of RPMs on an engine, because we're used to first, the legacy aircraft engines, which are somewhere between 2,500 and 3,300 RPMs. And then we have a lot of these automotive conversions, which are turning somewhere between 4,800 and 6,500. And now come Yamaha, and you're at 8, 9, 10,000 RPM. But the difference is, they were purpose-built as well, right? So they were designed with lighter components, smaller pistons, whatever, to turn that kind of RPM.
That's right. These engines are just happy turning RPMs like that. There's five valves per cylinder, double overhead cams. They're little valves. There's these little parts that can just change direction, you know, instantly. So they're just happy as can be running that RPM. Well, with the gearbox, now the propeller is just as happy as can be too. It's right at the RPM that you want a propeller. It's geared down almost 4 to 1. It's 3.83 to 1. It's nearly 4 to 1. So, you know, if I'm running 9,000 RPM, my prop is, it's going to be probably turning less than most guys are with their direct drive Lycomings and Continentals, let alone Jabrus and ULs.
So you're seeing an incredible amount of torque at your prop flange, your prop shaft then. And you've seen, tell me some of the numbers you saw with the thrust on your airplane, both on both engines.
I don't remember the max thrust I've seen on the stock one, but I see 1,000 pounds of thrust with my turbo, my prototype turbo. The new one I'm putting on, we'll see what it does, but I'm sure it'll be right up there, maybe more. Okay. It's amazing what 1,000 pounds of thrust does on an 800-pound airplane. It's a lot of fun.
And then last, pricing. This is now February 2020. Pricing is going to be changing. What is a ballpark cost of somebody wanting to order one of these engines from you, and then I guess maybe from Thomas, but just what is the pricing if somebody wants to buy one of these for their Highlander or whatever plane, kind of average cost of these engines?
Well, just like this right here, this is one that I'm getting ready for a guy that bought a Highlander kit from us. So I found the snowmobile, you know, I checked it out, I took it out of the sled. Do all the work, put it all together. This is about $23,000, and that's with the prop too. But it's pretty complete, bolt on the front of your airplane. If you did the turbocharged version, you could probably add another $20,000.
Okay, and this is the normally aspirated in somewhere around 150 horsepower based on the Yamaha rating.
That's correct.
All right, well, Steve, if somebody wanted to get in touch with you directly, what's the best way to get in touch with them? In touch with you to answer questions or to email or all that kind of stuff.
Well, to go on our website, wildwestaircraft.com, you can email us. My phone number's there. My phone's with me all the time. If I can answer it, I will. If I'm up in the airplane, leave a message, I'll call you back. But yeah, call me or email me, either one.
Remember to like and subscribe. We'll see you in the next episode.